Arthur and Uther, Bradley James and Anthony Head. Hi, guys.
Hi.
Hello, Northampton.
Series 3 now. Have your characters got a bit more worldly wise yet? Because it seemed to me someone new turns up, you go, we don't know you, we don't know who you are. Be in our gang.
Well, you, do you know what? You should be writing this show.
You
should be writing this show. Because someone new turns up and we... Well, usually someone new turns up and, you know, Uther and Arthur go, oh, you're new and we don't know who you are. We haven't had any background information on you. We trust you instantly.
Yes.
And then Merlin comes along and he says, oh, by the way, I think these guys might be evil. You probably shouldn't trust them. We go, no, Merlin, you've been here for far too long. You've come through for us in many a crisis. We don't trust you, therefore.
Who are these writers? Are they worth experience?
Yeah. I take credit away from them when I really shouldn't, because I think there's a lot of great stuff that's done in creating the show, and it's, you know, we're in our third series, as you say.
And it's largely Uther. Uther's there's a lovely guy that works on camera, and he's always in our... That's another one for Uther. He's Irish. But he always points out when Uther makes a really, really stupid decision, and it's usually involving chopping someone's head off, not trusting somebody, or trusting somebody.
Or locking someone in the dungeon. Or you notice that
no one
ever dies after being locked in our dungeons. They always get, right, they're going to be executed tomorrow, send them to the dungeon so they can think about it, and then in the morning, they've escaped.
Bradley, I don't think you're taking this part seriously at all.
Oh, believe
me. You're mocking it.
I like to see the fun in it, but I think it's because we have a lot of fun in the show. It's Saturday Night Escapism, you know, that's what we're trying to provide.
Oh, I love it. And the third 13-parter, it's quite rare in British TV, that, Anthony, isn't it?
It's very rare, and it's also rare to get the production values you get. I mean, in this day and age when you know, cutbacks are being made, it's glorious to see a show that is, it really is, that is so beautifully designed, so the costume design, the makeup, and it's shot beautifully. We went to see the first two episodes, which are, it's a two-parter, and we went to the BFI yesterday, the British Film Institute, to watch them back to back, and it was literally like watching this epic movie. It was just extraordinary. A, because you're seeing it on a big screen, but it's incredibly filmic. The CGI and the photography is just, I've not seen anything like it on television for a long time.
It's almost insulting, I think, to British programme makers, but it seems to me to have American qualities, the kind of stuff that you expect in America.
It's true.
How different is America? They seem to have longer runs in America. Often they have a third of a year, half of the year. Is there more money to make American programmes?
Well, Anthony, know more about
there is me, there is more money. There's about nearly twice, more than twice the amount usually that's available per episode. But this is something. I mean, it's just they've got very good at it. They've very, very, very carefully and cleverly picked locations. I mean, Pierrefonds, where we shoot in France, is the most stunning location.
Just outside Paris, isn't it?
Yeah, it's about an hour northwest of Paris. And the first time that anybody walks into the courtyard, they, you know, their mouths, jaws drop open.
Because you're stepping back in time, aren't you?
It's beautiful. When I walked into what is my throne room, I literally went, okay, I'm a king. I completely understand now. It's great when you get something, you know, that a lot of stuff these days is shot in Romania or Hungary, and although it's beautiful, you kind of feel that they're having to pull things together. This really is, you know, what they pay for is what they get on
screen. Did they try Britain for it? Had they looked around the UK?
They looked all over. We do use a couple of castles in Wales, because we also shoot on a trading estate in just outside of Cardiff. But it doesn't sound quite so glamorous, but, you know, Cardiff's cool, but the trading estate is a little bit dirty.
It ain't Paris, is it?
Well, it's a tin can, basically, but... and it's very, as I say, the design is brilliant. You don't know from one sort of shot to another whether you're whether you're actually in the original castle or whether you're on a soundstage. But we do use castles around Wales. This one particular one in Pierrefonds, it's just got this magical quality. It's extraordinary. It's beautiful.
It's convenient for a show with a wizard doing magic.
It helps.
Yeah. It's funny to me how the subject matter is back on TV, because growing up, Anthony, it was all Robin Hood and William Tell, wasn't it, for us? And now it's back again.
It's true. It's true.
Wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
In my day.
But it was.
It's true. And in fact, it is coming, because somebody was asking, there are quite a lot of medieval type shows. There are other shows about Camelot that are in pre-production. There are other shows about Borgias, and also, obviously, you know, we've we've started something. You know, medieval tales are coming back.
And you get good drag, don't you, in good chainmail and armour. It's nice, isn't it?
It is. You do know it after you've been a day in chainmail, I have to say. But it is. There's something about, you watch any bloke that sort of swans across the courtyard in a cloak, and as soon as the wind gets under their cloak, you see their walk slightly change. It suddenly becomes a swagger.
And Bradley, you're quite tasty with the sword now, are you?
I've had a lot of experience, I think, just purely because it's put into my hand every day. Mm. I you know, you naturally just pick up things up and find an ease with it, and I enjoy it as well. So
I like the fact that it's pre-Arthurian legend. That's what I like. He's got a past. That's what's good about him. He was spoilt and petulant, wasn't he?
There you go. Well, we've not really seen an Arthur like that before. They obviously were thinking to themselves, right, who can we get to play that?
Yes.
Ah, Bradley, give him a call.
Yes. So is he different because he's not a boy anymore? Are you now shaving Bradley now, are you?
Bradley isn't, Arthur is.
There you are.
Bradley's hoping that will come about some stage. You impress people with some facial hair. Yes. Arthur, I think, you know, just has servants to shave him.
Because you are the totty, are you not, Bradley?
I don't know about that. Ask a lady of perhaps a certain age or a certain, you know, whatever, and they might, you know, say, hey, you checked out that Anthony Head.
A certain whatever. That's what I appeal to.
What's that mean? Glaucoma? What's that mean?
I think a lot of characters, I think all the characters have their appeal. In fact, with all the guests we've got coming in, I go to the back of the list as...
Who have you got?
The totty list.
Who's coming?
Well, we have, without saying too much, we have a few characters who perhaps help to build the legend and will be sticking around after they appear. They're all better looking than me, so fans.
Oh, it's not true, Bradley.
Yeah, we've got some good looking guys coming in. I can take a step back.
A bit of competition, but you know, you're out there, brother.
Uther's a bit of a curmudgeon, isn't he, Anthony? He's opposed to everything, isn't he?
He's just a bit old school. That's all. I mean, if you don't understand it, just chop its head off.
What about him?
he's a Victorian father and an old school king, and he's just playing with a limited box of tools. That's all.
Has it gone to America yet? Have they taken this?
Yeah, it's doing really well. It's on Sci-Fi now, and it's somebody was bemoaning the fact that they'll have to wait till next year to see this season because they can't wait. It's doing really, really, really well.
Have you had much say about your characters? Because he could have been Mr. Shouty King, couldn't he?
He could have been, and you know, it's all hats off to Johnny and Julian, the producers, who basically have taken what we've given and run with it. There was no doubt right from the beginning that I wanted there to be there's a reason for what he does, and it's, as we've progressed, and his psychosis has deepened.
You wanted Hitler to have a heart.
Well, just that there is a reason for everybody doing whatever they do. Yes, I mean, somebody was saying last night, even Hitler sort of loved his mum and liked dogs.
What was that? Please tell them what somebody said after that. He wasn't all bad then.
And on that bombshell, we got a finish.
There we go.
There we are, ladies and gentlemen. Hitler was a nice fella. Who knew that was coming? It starts BBC One.
You heard it here first.
This Saturday at 7:25, and it's so lovely to have Merlin back. We love it. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.